Hello everyone and welcome to another ProGuides video. I'm Kangas and today we're going to be trying to help make sense of all these crazy changes that have been announced. And if you open up the patch notes like the average person and said too long, didn't read, we got you covered. This video is going to be giving you the rundown on all of the changes to AD carry itemization and explain the new items, when to buy them, and what you should be looking for in your games. Without further ado, let's get into the video.
First off, let's jump right into the new Mythic items. Mythic items are Riot's new shakeup to items. There are four specific things to keep in mind with Mythic items that make them so unique. First off, there are about 3 to 4 options per role that are specifically designed for those roles. Second, you can only have one Mythic item in your inventory at a time. Because of this, these items are intentionally overpowered. The third thing is that all Mythic items have either a really powerful passive or an active that allows you to augment your gameplay and adapt to what champions are on your side or the enemy's side of the rift. And the fourth thing that makes Mythic items so mythic is they all have a passive that grants you bonus stats for each legendary item that you possess, aka for every full item you complete. This means these items affect your gameplay from start to finish and increase the gold efficiency of all of the items you purchase thereafter. The Marksman Mythics look like they were actually designed by a Marksman player who had had enough of the LOL AD carry in 2020 memes. All 3 to 4 of the Marksman options look very appealing in different ways and provide an insane amount of power. They also solve a lot of the issues that are pain points for Marksmen, which I'll go over later. But let's get into those Mythic items, then the Legendary items, and finish it off with some suggested builds to help you all out. The first of the Mythic items we'll be talking about is Gale Force. Gale Force costs 3,400 gold, builds out of the new Noon Quiver, Cloak of Agility, Pickaxe, and 625 gold. It provides 55 attack damage, 20% attack speed, and 20% critical strike chance, as well as an active and a Mythic passive. The active Cloudburst causes you to dash in the targeted direction, firing 3 missiles at the lowest health enemy near your destination, prioritizing champions. It deals a total of 180 to 315 magic damage, increased against low health targets by up to 50%. It also has 45% bonus AD scaling. And the Mythic item passive of Gale Force grants all other legendary items 3% movement speed. This item, if nothing else, is fun. Having an RE dash for extra damage, mobility, and outplay potential is exactly what the Marksman class needs, much to the dismay of all the bruisers and divers trying to get on Caitlyn with Net, Flash, and now this item. But AD carries have been struggling for a very long time with not having options against dive and assassins, as well as the other issue of agency. One of the biggest complaints AD carry players have is that they feel they don't have enough agency over their games, and instead of letting the AD carry roam around the map, Riot has decided that they want to give AD carries an option where they can elect for more self-sufficiency. AD carries hated that they had to rely on their supports to really give them space in teamfights when they didn't have flash up, and now they can be that single independent AD carry who don't need no support. This item is one that I would recommend building early on since it's 3,400 gold and especially against teams that have ways to dive you. Or if you're playing a low mobility champion, this is most likely your go-to pick for Mythic items. But remember, these are all supposed to be situational items, and the 3% movement speed per legendary item scaling on Gale Force is actually really interesting to me, since it means you could potentially feel okay selling your boots and getting a 6th legendary item late game with all the extra movement speed you'll be sporting later in the game. Next up is Kraken Slayer. Oh boy, this thing is honestly ridiculous, and I think it'll be the first of the Marksman Mythic items to get nerfed. It costs the same as all the other Marksman Mythic, so all you compare on them are the stats, passives, and actives, and not so much the price point, which as a reminder, is still 3,400 gold. It builds out of exactly the same thing as Gale Force, Noon Quiver, Cloak of Agility, Pickaxe, and 625 gold as the combined cost, sporting 60 attack damage, 25% attack speed, and 20% critical strike chance that bring it down passive states that every third basic auto attack deals an additional 60 plus 30% bonus AD true damage. And the Mythic item passive grants you 10% more attack speed for each completed legendary item. This thing is nutty, and for 4 really good reasons. It is incredibly gold efficient even before factoring in any of the passives. It has the most raw stats out of all the Marksman Mythics. The Mythic passive just adds so much value as the game goes on and you complete even more items, and it synergizes with its own Bring It Down passive, since more attack speed means you're dipping into that passive more frequently. And oh boy, is that passive good. I expect this item to be the go-to for most AD carry builds, just because of the raw power it brings to the table, and is situationally agnostic, as you could always use more damage as a marksman. You also don't have to worry about using an active, which the vast majority of the player base forgets to do. If you take anything else away from this video, just know that Kraken Slayer is really good. Oh, and I believe this item also cycles the passive on you in the form of stacks, not on your enemy. So unlike Vayne's Silver Bolts, you don't have to hit the same target three times, and can instead attack a minion twice, then walk up with the empowered true damage. The third marksman intended mythic item is Immortal Shield Bow. With the same 3400 gold price tag, and a slightly different build path that includes Noon Quiver, Cloak of Agility, Vampiric Scepter, and 600 gold. This is probably the most situational of the three, as it adds the least damage to your champion, and is geared towards trying not to die. It has 50 attack damage, 15% attack speed, 20% critical strike chance, and 12% lifesteal. The passive lifeline says, when taking damage it would reduce you below 30% health, gain a 250 to 700 shield for 3 seconds. Additionally, gain 15% lifesteal for 8 seconds. And the mythic passive grants all other legendary items 5 attack damage and 50 health. The Immortal Shield Boat is your oh shit, I shouldn't have played this champion into this composition option. Unlike the Kraken Slayer, the damage output of this item is much lower. And when it comes to Gale Force, this item pales in comparison if you're trying to escape divers. But where this item will beat out the other two is a situation where you really don't have a way to escape and need to instead stand your ground. Gale Force will give you a dash, but up against something where your dash won't matter and you're already low mobility, this can give you a massive shield that will make you that much harder to kill. If escaping isn't an option and you like to be that frontlining AD carry, this is the option for you. I'd like to mention that even though there are assassin mythics specifically designed for assassins, when I looked at them, I do think that some might be picked up by marksman champions, especially Eclipse for someone like Draven or Senna. But the fact that you're limited to one mythic item means that it has to compete with the three marksman-focused mythics, and competing with the damage, efficiency, and ease of use with Kraken Slayer, as well as the mobility of Gale Force, is going to be really hard. But Eclipse looks incredibly good. So yes, there are other mythic items with attack damage on them, but they're most likely going to be really niche for AD carries. But I am going to throw Trinity Force in here because there will maybe be a few champions in the AD carry role that want to pick it up. Trinity Force costs a total of 3,333 gold. See what they did there? It builds out of Sheen, the new Hearthbound Axe, Kindle Gem, and 733 gold. It has 200 health, 35 attack damage, 35% attack speed, and 10 ability haste. The first passive is Threefold Strike. Your basic attacks grant 25 movement speed for 3 seconds. If the target is a champion, increase your base attack damage by 6%, stacking up to 5 times. You also get the same Sheen passive Spellblade that current Trinity Force has. After using an ability, your next basic attack is enhanced with an additional 200% base attack damage. The mythic passive grants all legendary items 10% attack speed. This item is a good option for AD carries that won't be relying on crit like Ezreal, but not things like Kog'Maw, and we'll get into that later. The extra base damage of the Threefold Strike passive grants you does feed back into Spellblade passive, so Trinity Force offers a lot of extra damage and attack speed as the game goes on, making it a good option. But once again, the Kraken Slayer is going to be better for basic attackers. Now let's get into all the legendary items that you'll be looking at as a marksman. First up, we have the Collector. It costs 3,000 gold, builds out of Serrated Dirk, Pickaxe, Cloak of Agility, and 425 gold. It has 45 attack damage, 20% critical strike chance, 18 lethality, and the Death and Taxes passive, which says dealing damage that would leave an enemy champion below 5% health executes them. Champion kills grant an additional 25 gold as well. This item looks good at first glance, but actually isn't really that powerful. 5% of someone's health around the time you would buy this is anywhere from 75 to 175 damage. Although it does offer critical strike chance and you want to load up on 5 critical strike chance items in your full build for that juicy 100%, the rest of the stats leave a lot to be desired. This item isn't really gold efficient, and even if you kill a lot of people, that 25 additional gold would have to go off a lot to make up that price difference. Oh yeah, and it's on kill, not on takedown, so there's that too. This probably doesn't fit into too many builds, but if it does, it would be really late into the game. I would avoid this item as there are just way better alternatives for right now. Next, we have Navori Quick Blades. Am I saying that right? costing 3,400 gold, building out of Caulfield's Warhammer, Pickaxe, Cloak of Agility, and 825 gold. This item grants 60 attack damage, 20% critical strike chance, 30 ability haste, and the passive Deft Strikes. Your critical strikes with basic attacks reduce your non-ultimate ability cooldowns by 20% of their remaining cooldown. This item is extremely powerful in the right hands, and I don't mean you gotta be skilled or anything, I just mean in the right champion's hands. This will be a core item in builds for champions like Ashe, who have access to critical strike right from the beginning of the game with her passive, meaning she'll be able to disgustingly abuse Hawkshot and reduce that cooldown all the time. Also, it doesn't say the critical strikes on champions. I see Ashe building this fairly early on as a second or third item, and then I see three or four other champions that may want this item too. Lucian in the mid game when he has gained enough critical strike chance to frequently reset his abilities, Tryndamere, who already gets a lot of critical strike early in the game, and there's never such a thing as spinning too much with him, and the last two are Senna and Jhin, since they also have access to crits rather early in the game. But I'm not completely sure about the last two, as they have a gated attack speed, and this item synergizes with critical strike and attack speed, since the more frequently you attack and that attack crits, you'll reduce your basic cooldowns. This item is already gold efficient without even factoring in the passive. I expect this item to be in a lot of spellcasting crit marksman builds. Some AD carries may be up against a Janna and look at Serpent's Fang as a viable option, but I'll cut to the chase here. Don't. This item is crap. The passive is worth very little bonus damage because of the lack of uptime that a shield has in the first place, and people aren't shielded forever. So you're paying a premium for a passive that you won't be using a lot. Just skip it. A tech item I want to mention here is Cerilda's Grudge. It costs 3,400 gold, builds out of Caulfield's Warhammer, Last Whisper, and 850 gold. Provides 45 attack damage, 30% armor penetration, and 20 ability haste, as well as the passive Betrayal. Betrayal says damaging abilities slow enemies by 30% for 1 second, making Cerilda's Grudge the AD version of Rylai's Crystal Scepter, especially since Frozen Mallet is no longer in the game. So this item will potentially see some play on champions like Ezreal, because remember, it says damaging abilities slow enemies by 30% for 1 second, which would make it so your ultimate, E, W, Q, all slow and allow for subsequent skill shots to be landed much easier. The 30% armor penetration is also a really good stat to have on this item, but the lack of critical strike chance makes it so that you'll probably shy away from it in most AD carry builds, unless you're a caster AD carry. I don't see this being built on a lot of other marksmen, but is potentially crazy on things like Garen. Go take it for a spin. Speaking of armor penetration, Mortal Reminder no longer has any on it, and is now purely focused on being a Grievous Wounds applying item. At 2,700 gold, and requiring an Executioner's Calling, Zeal, and 700 gold, this item gives 20 attack damage, 25% attack speed, 20% crit chance, 7% movement speed, and the new Sepsis passive. This passive states, dealing physical damage applies 40% grievous wounds to enemy champions for 2 seconds. Dealing 3 consecutive attacks to an enemy champion enhances this effect to 60% grievous wounds against them until the effect is allowed to elapse. First off, the stats on this item are already gold efficient if you're hitting someone with even a single ability that would heal them. This also gives you a grievous wound that is 50% more effective if you continue to focus the enemy, which is another amazing solution to a problem that AD carries have been facing for a while against incredibly durable tanks. This item also has that juicy 20% critical strike chance on it, so once again, expect this item to be really common in the mid game against teams that have a Soraka on them, especially against compositions with a single frontliner. Which brings me to the final thing about Mortal Reminder I like. It doesn't feel terrible to buy. Previously, it always felt bad to build Mortal Reminder because Lord Dominic's Regard provided more penetration, and it also cost a lot for really mediocre stats. Now, it is a fantastic option for almost anybody to pick up, and really gives you that extra bang for your buck. It shouldn't feel bad at all to grab an Executioner's Calling now and sit on it until later in the game, to then turn it into this monster. And speaking of monsters, next up is Guinsoo's Rageblade. This item is probably the most overtuned item Riot has released in a while. It only costs 2,600 gold, builds out of the new Rage Knife, Cloak of Agility, Dagger, and 900 additional gold. It gives you 40% attack speed and 20% crit strike chance. So some of the old stats on it are gone, but it now has two really incredible and game-changing passives, Wraith and Seething Strike. Wraith gives your basic attacks an extra 45 physical damage on hit per 20% critical strike chance, but you can no longer critical strike. This is huge. Kog'Maws and Vayne's are gonna celebrate with the introduction of not only the Kraken Slayer, but the new Rageblade. 45 damage on hit is more consistent than 20% critical strike, but when you hit 100% critical strike chance, that is 225 bonus damage per auto attack, which is the equivalent of critting with 300 AD, because remember, crits got nerfed to being 175% increased damage instead of 200%. And that's all before factoring in the second passive, which we haven't even mentioned yet, Seething Strike, which makes it so that every third basic attack applies your on-hit effect twice. No stacking required, just every third basic attack. This is so good for champions like Vayne and Kog'Maw that this will 100% be a first or second purchase for them. The fact I even mentioned it potentially being a first purchase on them over something like Kraken Slayer? That's crazy! But costing only 2600 gold makes this item really appealing. This makes it so even if an item doesn't have an on-hit effect on it, you're looking for an on-hit build. You can just build items that have critical strike chance on them and turn that into on-hit damage, which reaps the benefits of whatever stats, passives, or actives you've purchased. Next up is Phantom Dancer. Using two daggers, a zeal, and 1100 gold for a total of 2900 creates this item, and grants you 40% attack speed, 20% critical strike chance, and 7% movement speed. You'll notice immediately that the old shield on it and the primary function of Phantom Dancer as a survivability tool have been removed and placed on the Marksman Mythic item Immortal Shield Bow. The new passive, Spectral Waltz, makes it so that your basic attacks grant you the ability to walk through units and give you 7% movement speed for 2 seconds. In addition, attacking 5 times causes Spectral Waltz to also grant 40% attack speed for the same duration. Notice it didn't say champions. Attacking 5 times on anything, minions even, will give you 40% attack speed that doesn't go away until you stop attacking for 2 seconds. This item is a multiplier item as it will bring up to 80% attack speed to the table, but 2 seconds of not attacking can happen rather frequently in a teamfight, and having to stack it up again can be a big chore. Phantom Dancer would more be purchased for the 7-14% movement speed bonus it provides, and will likely fit into some on-hit builds that use Rageblade. But other than that, there are a ton of really appealing options now, and PD is gonna have to compete for those inventory slots. We talked about how Mortal Reminder lost its armor penetration earlier, but Lord Dominic's Regard has not, and is now specifically the percentage armor penetration item for Marksman, costing 2900 gold and building out of Last Whisper, Cloak of Agility, and 850 additional gold. This item has 30 attack damage, 20% critical strike chance, and 25% armor penetration, as well as the Giant Slayer passive. This gives you up to 15% bonus physical damage against champions with greater max health than you. Important to note that if you buy this item with Immortal Shield Bow, an item that increases your HP, it actually potentially will lower the amount of damage you're getting from the Giant Slayer passive. Other than that, this item is really strong and all the stats on it are really appealing. Riot has done a really good job of just adding 20% critical strike chance to almost every item, making it so that you have a smooth ramp up over your item build. This item will definitely be a core item in the mid game for almost all marksmen who are facing any tanks. But this next item may not be a core item for almost anyone on the Marksman roster, and it's Essence Reaver. Costing 2900 gold and building out of Caulfield's Warhammer, Sheen, Cloak of Agility, and 500 gold, Essence Reaver grants 40 attack damage, 20% critical strike chance, 20 ability haste, and now has the Sheen passive Spellblade on it, but with a Marksman twist. The Essence Reaver Spellblade states that after using an ability, your next basic attack deals an additional 100% base AD plus 40% bonus AD physical damage, and also restores 3% mana on a 1.5 second cooldown. This item may mean that, in certain conditions, Ezreal doesn't have to go Trinity Force, and can instead go for a different mythic item like Gale Force to be even more bursty and annoying. The fact it has really good stats and Sheen proc that scales with attack damage means this item won't be seen early on in most builds, but will typically round out a build that has 4 or 5 items. Speaking of item order, next up we have the item every marksman has been absolutely hating to purchase first, Infinity Edge. Costing 3400 gold and building out of the always expensive BF Sword, Pickaxe, Cloak of Agility, and 625 gold. IE now gives 70 attack damage, 20% critical strike chance, and the passive Perfection, granting an additional 8% critical strike damage per 20% critical strike chance. Meaning this item gives you 215% critical strike damage when you have 100% crit strike. But this item is worth a lot when purchased as a third item or later. Purchasing it before then is a pretty big waste. So celebrate the fact you don't have to get a BF Sword at all for the first 3/4 of the game, or maybe even the entirety of the game. IE is a mid to late game item that helps multiply the usefulness of your already purchased stats, like critical strike chance, attack damage, and attack speed. This item is the crit marksman answer to Rageblade, and should allow for marksmen to gain back some of their hard-hitting mid-game power. But the early game will be more consistent and less spiky in terms of getting randomly crit and burst down in lane from that 25% crit Caitlyn who just happened to luck out. Next up, we have Manimmune. Costing 2600 gold and building out of Tear of the Goddess, Caulfield's Warhammer, Sapphire Crystal, and 750 gold. This item gives you 35 attack damage, 400 mana, 15 ability haste, and the passives Awe and Mana Charge. Awe causes you to gain bonus AD equal to 2% of your maximum mana. Mana Charge is a bit different than before and states that striking a target with an attack or ability will consume a charge and permanently grant the item 3 bonus mana. This bonus mana gained is doubled if the target is a champion. This item transforms into Mirror Mana once 450 bonus mana has been granted, and you gain a new mana charge every 8 seconds and can hold a maximum of 4 charges. The big thing to note about this item is that it doesn't have to be a champion you hit, just hit anything, and it should take about 20 minutes to charge it up completely. Poor, poor Krugs. It also doesn't have the mana refund on it anymore, nor do you have to shoot random mystic shots while walking back from the fountain to charge it. After Manimmune upgrades into Mirror Mana, it has 35 attack damage, 850 mana, and 15 ability haste. The Awe passive stays the same as before, but a new passive is added in place of the old mana charge one, named Shock. When targeting champions, ability strikes and a basic attack deal physical damage equal to 4% of your maximum mana. This at first glance doesn't look like a huge change, but it is very different than the current Mirror Mana. First off, the Shock passive deals physical damage equal to 4% of your maximum mana, and doesn't need to consume your mana to do so. It also means that this damage is consistent, and won't scale down if you're running close to like the current Mirror Mana. And the other big thing is that it states that abilities also cause Shock to deal its bonus physical damage to the target. This damage is worth about 75 on-hit damage, and is going to be extremely powerful on champions like Ezreal, who want extra mana and already build Mirror Mana. I'm interested to see if it makes its way into any other marksman champions like Senna or Lucian, but we'll see. Next up for our legendary items is a reworked Blade of the Ruin King. Costing 3100 gold and building out of Vampiric Scepter, Recurve Bow, Pickaxe, and 325 gold. Orc gives 40 attack damage, 30% attack speed, 12% lifesteal, and 2 passives, Mist's Edge and Siphon. Mist's Edge should be a bit familiar, and makes it so that your basic attacks apply physical damage equal to 10% for melee and 6% for ranged of the target's current health. The other passive, Siphon, makes it so that basic attacking a champion 3 times deals 40 to 120 magic damage, and steals 25% movement speed for 2 seconds. I believe there is a cooldown on this item, so it isn't as broken as it looks at first glance, but it also means this item's active is now gone, and it isn't as controllable as before. I have a hunch the Blade of the Rune King may not be purchased because it doesn't have critical strike chance on it, so it doesn't really synergize with AD carry builds that want to hit that 100%, and it also doesn't help Infinity Edge or Rageblade's scaling synergy. But Rageblade builds still do like on-hit damage, so this item could work its way onto a Vayne or Kog'Maw build. I want to take a quick second to mention Ravenous Hydra. This item costs 3300 gold, builds out of Tiamat, Vampiric Scepter, Caulfield's Warhammer, and 100 gold, and it gives 65 attack damage, 20 ability haste, and 15% Omni Vamp, which is basically everything vamp. Spells, basic attacks, everything. The active on this item has been removed, and instead, the Cleave passive states that basic attacks and abilities deal up to 60% of your attack damage to other enemies near the target. Damage scales down with distance from the target, and only once per ability. This item's stats are already gold efficient without the passive being factored in, but once again, it doesn't synergize with any of the critical strike builds. But I want to mention that it isn't just limited to melee champions anymore. Ezreal can purchase this item for some wave clear, and there's also been some funny builds including Runance Hurricane and Ravenous Hydra where the bolts splash the Hydra damage. If nothing else, it seems like it could be fun to play around with. Next up for all the people excited about the on-hit Rageblade builds, it's Wit's End. For 3100 gold, and combining Hearthbound Axe, Negatron Cloak, Dagger, and 800 gold, you'll get 30 attack damage, 40% attack speed, 50 magic resist, and the Fray passive, adding 15 to 80 magic damage on hit to your basic attacks, and granting 20 movement speed for 2 seconds. Right off the bat, you'll notice it doesn't have critical strike chance on it, but the item itself is really good gold efficiency wise, and 15 to 80 on hit damage makes this item even better on hit damage than Rageblade converting critical strike chance, so you'll most likely be seeing this item on Kog'Maw and Vayne, granting them that extra magic resist when they need it in the mid game. The other magic resistance option for marksmen also got changed. So let's quickly talk about Maw of Malmortius. The 3100 gold requires you to have Hex Drinker, Caulfield's Warhammer, and 700 gold to purchase. It gives you 50 attack damage, 50 magic resist, 15 ability haste, and the lifeline passive, where upon taking magic damage that would reduce your health below 30%, you gain a 200 plus 20% of your max health magic damage shield for 5 seconds. This is a super good tech purchase versus AP assassins, and will provide you with the survivability that you need, even if you don't want to get the Immortal Shield Bow, which, by the way, shares a passive name with it, so don't try to buy these items at the same time. This is the item you buy if you're comfortable not getting 100% critical strike chance, and you also need to focus on surviving against a magic damage threat. This shield is massive, and you'll almost never die with this thing on. It rivals the old Phantom Dancer in terms of the shield strength, but also scales with maximum health instead of your level. And there's also been a change to add a physical damage cousin to Maw of Malmortius, and that is Death's Dance. Costing 3100 gold and building out of Chain Vest, Caulfield's Warhammer, Pickaxe, and 325 gold. This item has been geared towards being solely useful against physical damage threats, granting you 50 attack damage, 40 armor, 15 ability haste, and 2 passives, Ignore Pain and Defy. Ignore Pain makes it so that 35% for melee and 15% for ranged of physical damage taken is dealt to you over 3 seconds instead, similarly to the old passive. And Defy makes it so that champion takedowns reverse Ignore Pain's remaining damage, instead restoring 10% of your maximum health over the duration, and also gives you 30% movement speed for 2 seconds. It's important to note that the Ignore Pain passive says 35% for melee and 15% for ranged champions, of physical damage, not all damage. So Death's Dance is being tuned specifically as a tech purchase versus a lot of AD. Aside from all of the new and updated legendary items, there have been small balance changes to some of the old items to be adjusted for the new 20% critical strike chance meta Riot wants the items to follow, and adjusting stats accordingly. We'll run through these quickly and get to full builds right after. Rapid Fire Cannon is having its cost increased by 100 gold and attack speed increased by 5%, while the critical strike chance on it is going down by 5. Overall, this is a slight power nerf, and you definitely only purchase this item if you're going to be using the increased range passive on it. Otherwise, I wouldn't drop the gold. The next item is Stormraiser. This item is having its cost reduced by 500 gold, attack damage reduced by 10, attack speed increased by 5%, and critical strike chance reduced by 5. This item is busted. Stormraiser has been powerful for a while now, and with a 500 gold reduction in cost, I see this as being a very early purchase for almost all marksmen. It provides everything a crit marksman could want, alongside a really cheap price point. Definitely recommend fitting this second or third into your builds. Mercurial Scimitar is getting adjusted as well. It costs 500 less gold and builds out of QSS, Cloak of Agility, Pickaxe, and 125 gold, instead of requiring a Vampiric Scepter. It's losing 20 attack damage, 5 magic resist, and all 10% of its lifesteal, but it's also gaining 20% critical strike chance, making it another easy fit for marksman builds that have a QSS in them. So completing this item won't actually feel like something you have to do at the very end of the game, just because it's all you have left to upgrade. Riot also made sure that this item is quite efficient when it comes to gold value, so kudos to them. Now we have a few really interesting items coming up. Runance Hurricane is the first of these. It's having its cost increased by a whopping 800 gold. It's gaining 25 more attack damage, but losing 5% critical strike chance and 2% movement speed. And the passive bolt damage will now scale up from levels below or equal to 10, up to 18, and it goes from 40 to 70% total attack damage, not staying just at 40% like the current Runance Hurricane. This item is incredibly interesting and potentially really good in Rageblade builds, as it has the critical strike chance on it to add even more on hit damage. The price efficiency of this item with the 25 more attack damage on it is pretty close, but making it cost 3400 gold and scaling means you'll most likely try to complete this item later into the game, maybe 4th or 5th item. Another really interesting item that may shake things up is Bloodthirster. BT is having its cost reduced by 100 gold, and the build path will now require the normal BF Sword and Vampiric Scepter, alongside a Cloak of Agility and 600 gold, instead of the Longsword and 950 gold. The attack damage is being reduced by 5, but BT is gaining 20% critical strike chance. This is going to be an item that almost all AD carries will buy. The gold efficiency of it is insane, even before factoring in the shield you get from it. This will be in almost all AD carry builds that have critical strike chance. Lastly, I want to talk about the new Noon Quiver item. This item costs 1,300 gold and builds out of two longswords, a dagger, and an additional 300. It gives 30 attack damage, 15% attack speed, and a passive named Precision that makes it so your attacks deal an additional 20 physical damage to minions and monsters. When I mentioned at the start of this video that Riot did a really good job at addressing AD carry pain points, this is one of the biggest things they've done to alleviate the frustration felt in the role. This item only builds into mythic items, so you'll be starting the game off by trying to buy this, and it doesn't build out a BF sword, so you don't need to wait in lane until 1300 gold to recall and buy one item. Now, if you get sent back and have a bad laning phase, you can purchase a longsword or a dagger and feel really good about being your way towards your mythic item still. This is a huge change that makes it so that AD carries are harder to push out of the game right from the get-go. If something goes wrong in the lane, or your support is just trolling, you won't be left feeling completely helpless early game compared to your opponents. This item also has the nice little added bonus of giving you 20 more physical damage to minions and monsters, which means that for 1300 gold, the same price as BF Sword, you'll be dealing 50 physical damage more per basic attack, instead of 40 for BF Sword, making this all around a much better starting purchase. Alright. Finally, that does it for all the mythic and legendary items. And before we get into builds, I just gotta quickly mention that Static Shiv has actually been removed from the game, so you won't be seeing that in any of our builds. Riot found the lightning effect to be too difficult to balance and either felt too underwhelming or too overwhelming, without any real in between. It seems Riot has elected for more powerful items that have really powerful passives that you spend your money on based on what you want to do with your champion and what the game looks like composition-wise. Okay, so now that we've covered all the items, let's wrap this AD carry item guide up with a few builds for you. I'm going to go through what I believe will be a typical marksman build, followed by an on-hit marksman build, and wrapping it up with Ezreal, because why not? So let's start off with a standard marksman build. You'll typically be purchasing Kraken Slayer or Gale Force as your mythic item, followed by a Storm Razor as your second item. I see this as being the build path almost everyone will go as their first two items. Your third item will either be Bloodthirster if you need the defensive shield, or Infinity Edge if damage is what you're lacking. Then from there, your two remaining item slots will be a mix depending on your champion and situation. Since there are so many options, to avoid confusion, let's split these off into certain champion categories and situations. Your last two or so inventory slots should usually be some kind of item outside of your core build that you need to adapt to the game state. For example, this is where you would buy your Lord Dominic's Regard for armor penetration against tanky teams, your Mortal Reminder to finish the Executioner's Calling you hopefully bought earlier on in that Soraka lane, or upgrade that QSS into a Mercurial Scimitar, or even get something like a Maw of Malmortius or Death Stance versus Magic Heavy or Physical Heavy damage team compositions, respectively. But if you don't need to go for tech items here, or you've completed it and moved on to your final item, you have to think about what type of champion you're piloting. If you are an AD carry that can use the Nivori Quick Blades and you didn't get them in your second or third items, this is where you'll pick them up. So Ashe and Lucian, we got you covered. If you're a strong team fighting crit AD carry like Jinx, you'll go for Runance Hurricane to deal even more splash damage and make use of the scaled up passive. And if you're a spellcasting marksman who also enjoys critical strike chance, like Misfortune, you'll want to get Essence Reaver for not only the crit chance, but the big spellblade passive hits that have scaled up due to all the bonus attack damage you'll have at this point in the game. And if none of those options sound appealing to you, you can always go for a Phantom Dancer for the attack speed or Rapid Fire Cannon for the range. But those are typically purchased if you're going for a pure damage build and don't have to worry too much about the enemy team composition, a luxury that many marksmen never get. Now let's talk about the most likely on-hit builds that I think will emerge. Your core will be made up of Kraken Slayer almost every single time. I think Gale Force is good, but the extra damage from Kraken Slayer is most likely going to be the selling point for the on-hit build. Follow this up with a Gwinsu's Rageblade immediately afterwards to start getting those extra on-hits every 3 attacks. Rageblade allows you to open up your build to many different options. You'll typically stick to items that have high value stats and on-hit effects, but if you do need to buy an item like Mortal Reminder, you don't feel like you're losing a ton of damage in your build to do so. As such, your third item is where you want to exercise this flexibility. A typical purchase versus a magic damage heavy team would be Wit's End, which also offers a lot of on-hit damage and synergy as well. After that, get Mortal Reminder against teams with healing, Runance Hurricane if you're going to be pumping out damage in teamfights, or Phantom Dancer if you're going to be focusing on a single target and going for sidelane pushes. Typically, you won't build a Lord Dominic's Regards when it comes to on-hit builds, because you're using Silver Bolts or Bio Arcane Barrage, and just building more attack speed is going to do you more good at that point than armor penetration. Another good item to think about getting is Blade of the Ruin King, and then topping your build off with any of the crit items that you think fit your needs. Maybe Mercurial Scimitar. And last but not least, let's drop a quick build for everyone's favorite non-AD carry AD carry, Ezreal. Being a really heavy spellcasting and not so much basic attack focused carry, we're going to be helping out all of you scaredy cats in the back of the backline. Before you do anything else, buy tier. It's only 400 gold, and you want to get it stacking ASAP. As for your mythic item, try out either Gale Force for the extra mobility and burst, Immortal Shield Bow for the annoying amount of survivability it grants, or Trinity Force if you want to buy a mythic item that will grant you more basic attack damage later on in the game. From there, upgrade your Tier of the Goddess into a Man Immune and continue stacking it up. Your third item will be Essence Reaver if you didn't take Trinity Force as your mythic item, but if you did, then opt into something like Blade of the Rune King against most teams, Maw of Mammortius against magic damage heavy compositions, and I'm personally really attracted to the Serelda's Grudge, which covers the 30% armor penetration you would normally go Lord Dominic's Regards for, but it also offers 20 ability haste for your cooldowns and makes it so your damaging abilities slow enemies by 30% for 1 second, giving you a lot of utility as a mobile marksman who can consistently slow people down if you have the accuracy to back it up. Finish your build off with whatever defensive stats you need. Or, if you need to get a mortal reminder, be sure to get the Executioner's Calling portion of the item much earlier on in the game. A full build should look something like this. Gale Force, Muramana, Essence Reaver, Blade of the Rune King, and Serilda's Grudge. If you're trying out Trinity Force as your mythic item, then it'll look something like this. Trinity Force, Muramana, Blade of the Rune King, Serilda's Grudge, and then Mercurial Scimitar or Bloodthirster to finish things off.
And that's going to do it for our Season 11 Complete Guide to AD Carry Itemization. I hope you guys were able to follow along and not get too overwhelmed by all the new changes hitting the Rift. But at least now, I hope you're a bit more prepared to get into your games and have that leg up over your competition. Thank you all so much for watching, and as always, good luck on the Rift, stay hydrated, and wash your hands. I'll see you in the next one.